I'm Matt Beshirt in San Francisco for Nareit's REIT World, our 2018 annual conference. Joining me today is Spenser Allaway, retail analyst with Green Street Advisors. Spenser, thanks so much for joining us.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Now, the retail landscape continues to change, particularly in the mall space. Can you talk about what landlords are doing to remain competitive in this evolving environment?
Yeah, so generally speaking, we're seeing landlords focus on two key areas. So first, they're investing in their centers, and this ranges anywhere from the more traditional renovations. So this would just more or less improve the overall curb appeal of a mall. And then we're seeing things such as the implementation of different technologies throughout a mall. So this could include things like smart parking, interactive concierge services, or even personalized push notifications that would alert a consumer to deals ongoing at their favorite stores. Secondly, I would say that we're seeing a huge focus on the merchandise mix. So merchandising has always been very fundamental to the success of a mall. However, because we are seeing consumer preferences increasingly shift towards those experience-based concepts, it's important that landlords not only provide consumers with the goods they need, but also places in the malls to have social experiences. So this really extends beyond the traditional food and beverage or entertainment concepts that we repeatedly hear about. Now landlords are getting more creative. So they're hosting yoga sessions, they're having concerts or even augmented reality experiences within the mall so people can interact. So yes, improving the overall look and feel of the mall is certainly key, but I would say that there needs to be just as much emphasis placed on the social offering of the mall as there is on its overall functionality.
Now, in regards to the tenant mix, some mall REITs seem to be taking it one step further with the addition of non-retail uses like hotels or office buildings. How do these densification projects benefit retail real estate, and do you think that we're going to start to see some more of them?
Well, the more obvious benefit of densifying a retail asset is the hope that the mixed-use component, so whether that be a hotel or an office building, what have you, will ultimately increase the footfall of that particular center. However, because densification often requires a significant amount of GLA, these projects also provide REITs an opportunity to shrink underproductive retail space. So from a landlord's perspective, it's great because you have the opportunity to not only increase foot traffic to your center, but you also are able to reduce exposure to at-risk tenants. And while these projects tend to have material capital requirements, we do think that we're going to see more of these in the REIT portfolios because the teams have been very successful in identifying partners to help mitigate some of that development risk.
Now let's talk about net lease REITs, where retail tends to make up a decent portion of the portfolios. How is this sector positioned to weather some of the changes we're seeing in retail?
Yeah, it's a great question because, as you said, retail does make up a significant portion of the REIT portfolios. But it's interesting because unlike the mall business, which we all know is highly susceptible to e-commerce and ongoing store closures, net lease is a much more insulated business for several reasons. So first, the portfolios are extremely diversified. So even if there were to be e-commerce disruption within a particular industry, or perhaps you had lackluster operational performance from a few tenants, the impact to the portfolio is going to be minimal. Secondly, the REITs have done a tremendous job over the last few years transitioning away from what we would deem traditional retail property into more service-oriented concepts that are inherently more insulated from disruption. And lastly, and most importantly, the average lease duration in the net lease space tends to be about 10 to 15 years, so this naturally protects the REITs against cash flow volatility. So overall, the general composition of the portfolios, coupled with the lease terms, tends to make net lease a much more stable business relative to the more traditional property types like malls or strip centers.
And finally, while we know there's obviously a lot of headwinds facing the retail space, what are some of the few more positive things that are occurring right now in retail?
Yeah, I would say the biggest thing that we've seen in retail so far this year has just been a more positive overall sentiment. So Green Street believes that this is largely a function of an improving retailer base. We've seen store closures slow rather significantly relative to 16 and 17. You have a healthier consumer benefiting from a fairly strong economy, as well as some tax cuts earlier in the year. And then also we've seen sales rebound very significantly in the REIT portfolio. That said, there's obviously still a bit of a supply-demand imbalance. And what I mean by that is that we're still seeing more stores close than we are open. However, our recent report from Clicks to Bricks highlights the fact that there's a growing constituent of digitally native brands that are taking space in high-end locations. And the fact that these more innovative brands, which by the way, are extremely cautious and selective in how they choose to grow, are saying that brick and mortar is a must in terms of their long-term growth strategy, this is a huge stamp of approval for retail real estate. So not only are we seeing the overall narrative begin to improve, but we're also seeing actual validation by way of these digitally native brands for the relevance of higher end retail real estate.
Spenser, thank you so much for joining us.
No, it was a pleasure. Thank you.
For more from REIT World 2018, be sure to visit NAREIT's website, REIT.com.